tonight that the Lord began to deal with my heart about. One of them being the spirit of Jezebel, the other the spirit of Athaliah. Two very powerful spirits, two very dangerous spirits. And when I think about this, now, let me start with the spirit of Athaliah. Now, there are other attributes to her that spirit, but the spirit of Athaliah, one of the things that it goes after is the generations of the future. If you pay attention to what's going on in the church today, we have millennials who don't want to go to church anymore because the spirit of Athaliah has come to attack our seed and try to take away the seed of the body of Christ. And so what happened, now if you understand the nature of Athaliah, Athaliah was, what she did was she usurped, after her husband died, then she killed all of her male grandchildren, except one who was hidden, Lord Jesus, I can start right there, who was hidden in a priest's house. The one child, the one that was preserved, was hidden in the house of a sanctified priest, Lord Jesus. I need to know tonight, is there anybody in here who is determined to be a sanctified priest? Hey, you may not have children, maybe you've got grandchildren now, or whatever, whoever's connected to you. Will you be the house of the sanctified priest where that one can be hidden so that that one can come to know God? Athaliah likes to attack the generations. She also, she despises godly authority. The spirit of Athaliah despises godly authority. If you pay attention in the church world right now, that spirit hates godly authority. When men of God and women of God stand up in authority, everything around tries to fight against it. Does not want the real men of God, real women of God, to stand. Wants to bring destruction to the voice of the men and women of God. So now let me talk about Jezebel. Jezebel, now I know we talk about Jezebel's actions of witchcraft. I get it. But let's go beyond her witchcraft to her spirit of manipulation. Jezebel had a spirit of manipulation, and let me go deeper. Not only was it a spirit of manipulation, but it manipulated leadership. She manipulated her husband, told him, go take that garden that did not belong to him. Manipulation is the spirit of Jezebel. And if you look at the body, can I preach like I feel it tonight, y'all? Oh, God, if you look at the body of Christ right now, there is a spirit that is causing manipulation to the men and women of God, and specifically the leadership, because watch this, what people want to hear is how to be successful. They want to hear how to do well in life. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't have a problem with being successful. I don't have a problem with having finances. I don't have a problem with being prosperous. What I have a problem with is when that is the message and we do not teach people what it means to go after God for themselves. We don't teach people what it means to seek the Lord. We don't teach people what it means to take on the nature of Christ Jesus. So I submit to you, you can have stuff but not have the nature of God. And the lie that the spirit of Jezebel has done, it has manipulated by the way it gives. See, watch this. The people don't give unless they've been entertained. They want you to tune up. They want you to do all this stuff. And they take you through all of these rigmarole. And they don't give. They don't support ministry unless you entertain them. Jezebel also does not like the voice of the prophetic. Let me put it like this. The spirit of Jezebel hates the now word of God. The prophetic voice word of God. And she hates the mind of God being released into the hearts of the people. It's okay for you to get all this stuff, but don't get the mind of God. Because if you ever get the mind, see, let me tell you, the mind of God, what it does, it reveals the heart and the mind of the Father. It reveals the heart and the will of the Father. And if you're going to do this thing, you're going to need the heart and the will of the Father. Can I go deeper? Not only do you need the heart and the will of the Father just based on the book, you need his heart and his will for every moment of your life. I remember when David was in battle, and one time David was in battle, and while he was fighting, God said, go up and pursue, and surely you shall recover all. But then there was another time he sought the Lord and said, God, how am I supposed to go in the battle? And the Lord said, don't go up this time. He said, go around south and then wait there until I tell you to move. You're going to hear a sound in the mulberry trees, and then when you hear the sound, that's when you're supposed to move. We try to move on our own, but we don't have the mind and the will of the Father. But today, I want to focus on Jezebel for a moment, because we are inundated with messages about living a good life and prosperity, but it is pseudo-spiritual. This generation is pseudo-spiritual. If you ask them what they do, they say, I'm not religious, I'm spiritual. That's what they say. And so the problem is, we deal with this lesson. Watch this. There's a language and a lesson that has gone lacking in the church. And that language and that lesson is growing into the full measure of Christ. I stand and I speak an open rebuke to every leader, not in this house, but to every leader that does not stand and make a priority out of seeing the body of believers come into the fullness of formation of the full nature of Christ in them. Oh, y'all not talking. It should be the desire of every pastor, of every leader, to now develop the people of God into the fullness of the Christos.
Yes.
Now, when I talk about Christ in this, I'm not talking about what we call the last name of Jesus. Hello, somebody. I'm talking about the anointing, that thing that separates you, that thing that empowers you. I'm talking about the anointing of the Holy Ghost that rests upon you and within you. Ah, God, it is so amazing to me when we go to the book of Genesis, ladies and gentlemen. In Genesis chapter number 1, it talks about the Lord says, let us make man, let us create man in our image and in our likeness. God was and is a spirit. When he created you, when he created me, we are spirit. But in order to operate in this realm called the earth realm, we have to have an earth suit. Which is why he then, watch this, chapter number 2, he says, now, we're going to, and the Lord God formed. Y'all going to find it in just a minute. And God formed man. And God formed, okay, let me give it to you. He gave shape to man. In the beginning, when God spoke and said, let us create man in our image and in our likeness, we weren't much more than an abstract. But it wasn't until he then took his hand, so to speak, and began to form man out of the dust and gave shape to man and then breathed into that form the breath of life. And then man became a living soul. We couldn't really come into fullness in the earth until we were able to operate according to the laws of the earth, which require the body. Am I making sense tonight, Joe? And so, God formed formed us. So what does it have to do with anything? Because when you gave your life to Christ, Christ was an abstract. He was an idea. You accepted. He was a seed, if you will. Come on. See, because if you take a seed and you put a seed in the ground, you don't know what's going to come up out of that seed. You don't know how many branches are going to come from that seed. You don't know how much fruit is going to come from that seed. You don't know how many leaves are going to grow on that tree. All you know is you put in the ground a seed. So in the beginning, a seed is just an abstract. It's not until the right amount of light. Preach long, I think I will. It's not until the right amount of light hits the right amount of dirt. The right amount of water hits the right amount of dirt. Some of us look at our lives and wonder, God, why did I have to go through everything that I went through in my life? Why wasn't I born on the right side of the track? God, what's wrong with me? But God said I had to let you be in the right amount of dirt. I put the right amount of light until something happened on the inside of you till Christ took shape. Yeah. 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 All
right. That's good. That's good.
Yeah. So, yes.
Y'all sit down. I gotta work my way through this. So, watch this. He wants us to come into the full measure of his form of the Christos. Ephesians 4:11. This thing messed me up. I was reading this today. Ephesians 4:11. Y'all know it says, and he gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, to the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. Watch this. To a mature man. That's what I'm working on tonight. I'm working on challenging the people of God to go after maturity. It says, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. Somebody say, I want the fullness of Christ. I want the fullness of the Christos to be manifested in my life.
Hallelujah.
I can't begin to talk about, tonight I'm just going to set a stage. Now tomorrow I'll really hit that kingdom authority on a deeper level. But I'm going to set the stage tonight, alright? We can't even begin to talk about kingdom authority until we start talking about our identity.
Alright.
How can you have kingdom authority if you don't have your identity? 1 John chapter 3, verse number 2 speaks to us very clearly. It says, beloved, now are we the what? Sons of God. I submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, that most of us don't even walk like we're sons of God. We don't even know we're sons of God. We have been convinced out of the idea that we are sons of God. I'll show you. Because the manipulation of the spirit of Jezebel has put into the church that if things are going wrong, if things are going bad, if things aren't going like I want them to go, then it must mean that I'm somewhere out of the will of God, or something's going on with me, whatever, or God's not with me. That's what the spirit of Jezebel has introduced into the church, the manipulation that has introduced into the church to make people believe that because something is not working right for them, they must be outside the will of God, or that God is not with them. Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible says that with every man that is born on this earth, our days are going to be full of trouble. So when we finally come to grips with the fact that our days are going to be full of trouble, listen, if you are living anything and you say you name Christ, what do you expect the devil to do? Okay, let me work it right here. Watch this. I need you to get this tonight. If you're taking notes, you need to get this point right here. Because when they teach you in seminary, they talk about something called the law of first mention. The law of first mention deals with number one. It sets a precedence. It sets an order for things. And it also sets a preeminence. It becomes the foundational truth on which something is built. Okay, so when God created man and he created woman, he said to them in Genesis 1, 26 to 28, he said, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth, and then watch this, and have dominion.
Dominate.
Take over. This is your land. This is your territory. This is your place. I want you to rule your place. Oh, I'm preaching to somebody already. He says, I want you to rule your environment. And so, of course, we know man gave up that rule, so on and so on. But Jesus turned around and said the same thing when he came. He told man to be fruitful and multiply. How did he say it? He said, go and preach the kingdom. Are you hearing me tonight? He said, preach the kingdom. Make disciples. Reproduce the nature of Christ. Bring forth the power of the kingdom in the earth.
Yes.
That's what he told us. So he basically reiterated, watch this, reiterated the first order. But wait. See, what many churches have done, they put a major focus on the ministry of deliverance and on the ministry of dealing with demons. Yeah. Says, you know what? As the Lord was talking to me, he said to me, he said, Long, it was basically like an oh, by the way. I said, okay. And here's how he explained it. He said, my assignment to you is go and produce the kingdom. Now, along the way, you are, because you are doing my will, because you are operating within my plan, there is something that is going to oppose you. There are some things that are going to oppose you called devils. Are y'all feeling me now? So, oh, by the way, since those devils are going to oppose you, you keep focused on the assignment of building kingdom. The devils are going to oppose you while you're doing it. Don't make them your focus. Make the kingdom your focus. I wish I had a church right there. Don't make the devil your focus. Make the kingdom your focus. And when you run up on a devil that tries to oppose you from your kingdom assignment, that's when you take on what he said. Behold, I give unto you power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means harm you. So it's kind of like an oh, by the way. When you run into those, handle them. Talk somebody around you and say, when you run into them, handle it. Why are you running scared of a devil? You don't have to run scared. You just go after your kingdom assignment. Keep moving forward. But when you run into one of those bullies, you stand up and you handle it. Tell somebody else. I'm trying to behave, Apostle. God have mercy.
Handle it.
Woo! Handle it. Now, here's what we got to do. See, because I talked to you. First thing I said, we don't know identity, right? I said, beloved, we are now the sons of God. Now, Romans chapter 8 teaches us that we have received not the spirit of bondage again unto fear. Hello?
Hello.
Yeah. But it says we have received a specific spirit. What does it say we receive? The spirit of adoption. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let me say that again. We have not received the spirit of bondage again unto fear. Mm-hmm. But we've received the spirit of what?
Adoption.
Come on, talk with some authority.
Adoption.
Whereby we now cry, Abba, Father. Oh, God, no. See, this thing we talk about, I want Christ to be formed. I want the Christos to be formed in me. Watch this. It can only happen when you understand your sonship. When you begin to live by the rules of the house that you've been adopted into. Let me paint this picture for you. You were of your father, the devil. This was his house over here. When I lived in this house, I was trained to be selfish. When I lived in this house, I was trained that I didn't have to forgive anybody. Oh, y'all gonna talk to me in here? When I lived in this house, I was trained that I only had to love the folk that loved me. When I lived in this house, I was trained to live in fear. Anybody ever lived in this house? These are some of the things that you learn in this house. But here's the problem. The Bible now says that when we came to Christ, we were translated out of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. Lord have mercy. We were brought out of darkness into the kingdom of life. We were brought out of darkness to show forth the praises of him who called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. But here is the challenge, ladies and gentlemen. Because if I spent 15, 20, 30, whatever amount of years in this house, my mind is programmed by the ways of this house. So when I get translated out of that house and get moved into this house, the struggle is now that I've got to learn the ways of this house. And the struggle, the reason why there are people who are still fighting with certain sins in their life and certain things going on, because they have not been translated in their mind. They've not dealt with the transformation of their mind and to live by the laws and the rules of this house versus that one. I'll show you. Over here, in our flesh, it's hard to forgive. Somebody who hurt us, somebody who let us down, it's hard to forgive when you first come into this thing or when that area of your life. See, because watch, if you lived in that house over there and now you get adopted into a new house, think about a teenager that gets adopted into a new house. He's in a whole new environment. So he tends to be rather reclusive and draw back. He doesn't draw close to the father. Oh, God. Because he's not sure whether the father really loves him or not. He's not sure if the father is really going, is he going to keep me or is he going to throw me? Here. it now forces you into a place where when you get over here, you live in that same fear that I'm going to be dropped again. I'm going to be broken again. I'm going to be hurt again. So you don't allow yourself to be released in that place.
Come on. Come on.
Yeah. Yeah. So what the Father does is he says, I understand where you are. Mm-hmm. And I'm with you through the process. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to work you through it.
Glory. Yes. Yes.
He knows, he says, the steps of a good man are ordered. Now I know we talk about the steps being the physical steps, but I come to tell you the steps of your deliverance, the steps of your freedom, the steps away from the mindset that you developed over there. Oh, I can't get a church right there. That pain and that hurt and the spirit of fear that you lived in over there. Of a good man. What God is going to do is he's going to orchestrate your life and navigate you in the right places to begin to cause you to see that over here on this side, there is hope, there is peace, there is joy. You don't have to live in fear. He's going to take you step by step by step by step by step until you see total freedom.
And some of
these folk that call themselves saints don't make it much easier for you to come out of the spirit of fear and when it comes to serving God. Somehow they grabbed on and made it like they were God. Any of y'all ever had big brothers or big sisters who called themselves whooping you? And mama and daddy said, hold up. No, you don't put your, you didn't burgle, so you don't put your hand on. Oh God. Only the one who birthed you has the right to put their hand on. So we got big brothers and big sisters who make it hard for us to try and embrace this thing that God is doing in our life. But over here in this house, there has to be, watch this. First, you got to understand. Notice what I said in the beginning? I said, your identity. When you were over here, you had no identity. Come on, Ezekiel. When I saw you polluted in your own blood, I picked you up. I washed you. And I said to you, live. But then he brought you into his house. Well, baby, here's the joy of that thing. He didn't just bring you in as a foster child.
Hallelujah.
You're going to get it in a minute and you'll know when to shout. I said, he did not just bring you in as a foster child. Because when you're just a foster child, you're potentially only there for a limited time. But when you are adopted, not only are you there permanently, but you are also, your name gets changed. Your name gets changed. I was a son of darkness, but now I'm a son of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, I'm a son of God. Ah, oh, beloved, beloved, beloved. Now are we the son of God? Look at somebody and tell them, I need you to encourage them. See, we're not going to be those brothers and sisters like the prodigal son, brother. We're not going to be like